I am Dr. Latif from Department of Medicine of the Sahid Trust Hospital. Today I will be delivering a second lecture, but first on the online. The previous was taken in the Westwood branch conference hall. So in the start of the lecture, I offer an MCQ to the students of fourth year MBBS. The MCQ is the immune destruction of the red cells by antibodies occur in which of the following condition? The first option is paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria, prosthetic heart valves, disseminated intravascular coagulation, hemolytic disease of the newborn, products of Clostridium perfringens infection. Now this is the answer key. You know, the option D was the correct answer, which was hemolytic disease of the newborn. Okay, so in the all the coming lectures we will be starting with the either MCQ or SCQ. Of course I know that I am not able to find the answer from you because this is an online lecture, but first I will show you the MCQ and followed by the key, so that you are trained in the manner that you start solving the MCQs on the online also. So now the today's topic is the hemolytic anemias. In the previous lecture, the start of the hemolytic anemia was introduced to you, and today's lecture is on the hemolytic anemias. The learning objectives are that after the lecture you will be able to enlist the causes of hemolytic anemia, you will be able to take the history of the hemolytic anemia, you will be able to enumerate the investigations of the hemolytic anemias, and you will be able to describe the complications and treatment of the hemolytic anemias. Now the first of all, the causes of the hemolytic anemias. They may be immune mediated, in which there is direct antiglobulin test positive, or in other words, the immune mediated one are those in which the Coombe test is positive. The sub causes may be drug induced, in which there is formation of RBC antibodies. There are antibodies against the RBC's membranes, and the classical example is penicillins. And the second happening in the same heading is that there is production of immune complexes. The example is quinine. Quinine causes the production of immune complexes against the antigens, and these complexes lyse the RBCs or they cause the hemolysis. Then is the AIHA or autoimmune hemolytic anemias. Are those in which there are autoantibodies and the hemolysis extravascular, and there may be spherocytosis in the autoimmune hemolytic anemias. This is not the classical spherocytosis, but because of the autoimmune hemolytic anemia, the shape of the cell on peripheral picture may be like spherocytes. Then the subclass is warm autoimmune hemolytic anemias. It is also IgG mediated, and these antibodies bind at the temperature 37 degree centigrade, which is the optimal temperature for warm autoimmune hemolytic anemia. The causes of the warm autoimmune hemolytic anemias are, number one, idiopathic. Number two, it may be because of the lymphoproliferative disorders, including chronic lymphocytic leukemia, lymphomas, systemic lupus erythematosus, and the drugs. Now the treatment of the autoimmune hemolytic anemias are, first of all, the steroids, followed by the immunosuppressive agents, and splenectomy is the last resort when the steroids and immunosuppressants, they are not effective. Now the second class is cold autoimmune hemolytic anemia. The second class of autoimmune hemolytic anemia. It is again IgG mediated, but the hemolysis at the low temperature, the antibodies bind at 4 degree centigrade, but it is through activation of the cell surface complement. The causes of the cold autoimmune hemolytic anemias include mycoplasma infection, Epstein-Barr virus infection, infectious mononucleosis, syphilis, infections with the E. coli, listeriosis, malaria, trisomy, systemic sclerosis, DPT, vaccination. So remember that whenever you offer the vaccination to the children, I mean the DPT vaccination, there is a chance of cold autoimmune hemolytic anemia. So after the DPT vaccination, you should check the peripheral picture of the patient to rule out the hemolysis. Now these patients, they present with chronic anemia and acrocyanosis, I mean the peripheral parts of the body, they have the cyanosis, and the patient may have Raynaud phenomena, which in means that there are color changes of the hands when you put them in the cold water or in the warm cold weather. The treatment of the cold autoimmune hemolytic anemia is keep the harm parts of the body warm, and the drug of choice is chlorambucil in cases of cold autoimmune hemolytic anemias. Now next is paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria. The causes of the paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria are viruses, syphilis. Mechanism is Donnez-Lentz-Jenner antibodies to RBCs in the cold weather, and it is also complement mediated, and there is lysis on rewarming. It is isoimmune type, and usually the acute transfusion reaction hemolysis in the newborn is the classical example of the paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria. Then is the direct antiglobulin Coombe test negative autoimmune hemolytic anemias. It comprises only 2% of all the cases of the autoimmune hemolytic anemias, and the causes are autoimmune hepatitis, hepatitis B and C, post flu vaccination, and the drugs are implicated in the causation of the Coombe negative autoimmune hemolytic anemias are piperacillin and rituximab, which is a monoclonal antibody. Then microangiopathic hemolytic anemia, otherwise known as MAHA, there is a mechanical damage to the RBCs and there is intravascular hemolysis. The classical feature found on the peripheral film is schistocytes. So if you get a report of the peripheral picture and you find there are schistocytes reported, the diagnosis on the card, which means that the patient is suffering from MAHA or microangiopathic hemolytic anemia, which is an intravascular hemolysis. The causes of the MAHA are hemolytic uremic syndrome, TTB or thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura, DIC, preeclampsia, eclampsia, and prosthetic heart valve diseases. Now these are the schistocytes. The arrow indicate, now this is the RBC is like as if the half of the RBC has been slashed. So these are the schistocytes. Remember their shape, and if you find anywhere on the picture or on the peripheral film proportional report, then the diagnosis is MAHA, and the causes have been cited in the previous slide. Then the malarial infections. In the malarial infection, there is hemolysis, and the patient can have black water fever. The patient passes Coca-Cola urine or Pepsi-Cola urine, and this is because of the hemoglobinuria, and all infections can exacerbate hemolysis. Then the parvoviruses cause hemolysis. They reduce bone marrow erythropoiesis, and aplastic anemia can occur, but there are no retics or reticulocytes. This is, you see, the black water fever. The bottle A is containing normal urine and bottle B is containing black water urine. This is because of the intravascular hemolysis. And bottle 3 or jar 3 is having diluted black water urine. Say this is sort of purple color or maroon color. But classically, I have seen a case who presented to me with fever, he was comatose and he was passing Coca-Cola or Pepsi color urine, and he was having hemoglobin urea, and the CBC showed the plasmodial infection in the RBCs. So his blood film was positive for malarial parasites. So this is cerebral malaria. Then paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobin urea, another cause of the hemolytic anemia. This is an acquired stem cell disorder. There is hemolysis at night, and the patient suffers from, when he wakes up in the morning, he finds hemoglobin urea, I mean the black color urine. The causes may be marrow failure, thrombophilia, and in the laboratory investigation you will be finding hemosiderin urea, and flow cytometry is another option for diagnosing the paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobin urea, and treatment is anticoagulation, monoclonal antibodies, and stem cell transplantation. It is a difficult disease to be treated. Then hereditary hemolytic anemias they include G6PD deficiency. It is an X-linked disorder, and there is RBC enzyme defect more in the males, and the regions affected are Mediterranean, Africa, Middle East, and Far East. And sometimes the patient may remain, commonly the patients remain asymptomatic, but they may get oxidative crisis because of some drugs or some infections, and there is low glutathione production, and it is precipitated by drugs like primaquine, sulfonamides, aspirin, and exposure to broad beans and favism. Now, how do they present? There is rapid anemia and jaundice. On lab films, you will find on the peripheral picture white cell and blister cells. You can see in the slide the white cells as well as the blister cells. They have been arrowed, and on the right side there are white cell, and on the left side there are blister cells. Now the treatment of the hereditary hemolytic or G6PD deficiency hemolytic anemia is avoid HINA, avoid the drugs which have caused the precipitated the G6PD deficiency crisis, and transfusions. Then is the another enzyme defect is pyruvate kinase deficiency. It is an autosomal recessive disorder, and there is low ATP production, low RBC survival time, and the patient presents with neonatal jaundice, but sometimes late jaundice can also be the finding, and the patient does have splenomegaly. On laboratory, enzyme assay is diagnostic. The treatment is splenectomy, sometimes is required in severe forms. Then is the membrane defect. The membrane defect disorders, hemolytic anemias, the classical example is hereditary spherocytosis, which is an autosomal dominant disease, and it is a Coombs test negative disorder, and there is extravascular hemolysis. The spherocytes are less deformable, which means that they do not mold themselves when they pass to the vessels and spleen, and thereby they being spherical, they are captured in the spleen and destroyed there. The signs are the patient presents you with the jaundice and anemia, and the patient, when you palpate the abdomen of the patient, you will be finding splenomegaly, and the patient on ultrasonography may have bilirubin gallstones. The laboratory analysis shows low hemoglobin, and the reticulocytosis is there, but it is never greater than 6% of the reticulocytes, and unconjugated bilirubin is very high in this disorder, the hereditary spherocytosis. Now see, these are the spherocytes. They are more rounded compared to the double-shaped normal RBCs. Now these are the bilirubin gallstone. They are yellowish in color, and whenever you find these stones, you can make the diagnosis instantly that these gallstones are because of the hereditary spherocytosis hemolysis. Then another defect, hereditary elliptocytosis, is the type of the subtype of the membrane defect hemolytic anemia. It is also autosomal dominant. The patient remain most of the times asymptomatic, and they provide the benefit of this elliptocytosis. The patient remain protected from the malaria, but the 1% has severe disease and they die in the utero. The treatment is folate supplement, and splenectomy is curative in hereditary elliptocytosis if it presents in a sphere form. These are the elliptocytes, classical. You remember, see their shapes, and remember forever that elliptocytosis is a lethal disease sometimes. Now, the thalassemias, are very commonly found in our country, and the causes are genetic. There is unbalanced hemoglobin synthesis. Thalassemia is basically hemoglobin defects. So unbalanced hemoglobin synthesis means there is underproduction, no production of one globin chain. You know, the alpha and beta chains are commonly, and delta and gamma are also there, but commonly alpha, beta are more common. So the unmatched globin precipitate, if one is absent, the other one remains unmatched. It precipitates in the cells and it causes the lysis of the RBCs, which you call as hemolysis. The cells are damaged and there is hemolysis of the RBCs in the marrow. And it is common in Mediterranean region as well as in the Far East regions. Hemoglobin review. Now, each complex consists of four polypeptide chains which are non-covalently bound, four heme complexes with iron bound, four oxygen binding sites, the two alpha normal adult, normal adult hemoglobin A, HbA, has 97% alpha 2 beta 2 chains, and the HbA2 has 2.5% alpha beta chain, and hemoglobin, fetal hemoglobin, there is only 0.5% alpha 2 gamma 2 chains. The early embryo begins with alpha, gamma, epsilon, zeta chains, and after about 10 weeks the epsilon and zeta chains are replaced by alpha, beta and gamma chain. Near birth, beta replaces gamma, so gamma also becomes depleted or absent, and a small amount of yet a 6 delta hemoglobin is produced. Now this is the structure which I have described you: alpha change, beta change, heme group, and iron binding sites on the heme groups. You know, there are two alpha chain, two beta chain, and there is iron on the heme groups, right? So this is the structure review for you. Globin chains, alpha chains, they have 141 amino acids. The chromosome code is 16 number. They are found in normal adult hemoglobin A1 and A2. The beta globins, they have 146. Compared to 141 in alpha chain, there are 146 in beta globin. The code chromosome is chromosome number 11. It is found in high hemoglobin A. Then is the delta globin. It is found in hemoglobin A2. Delta globin found in hemoglobin A2, but small amount in the adults. Then the gamma globulin found in fetal hemoglobin. Now zeta globin found in embryonic hemoglobin. Now remember the abbreviations of the alpha, beta, gamma, epsilon, delta and zeta chain. They have written before the name, before the alpha its sign is written, before the beta its sign is written, before the gamma its sign is written, before the epsilon its sign is written, like E, and delta before the delta, and the zeta unique. Okay, so remember these abbreviations of the alpha, beta, gamma, epsilon, delta and zeta. Again, sometime you fail to remember and which creates a difficulty in remembering the description of the globin types, hemoglobin types. So hemoglobin types, again the hemoglobin A1 is 90% and the chains are alpha 2 beta 2. Hemoglobin A2 is 2.5% and the chains are alpha 2 and gamma 2. And hemoglobin F is less than 1% and the chains are alpha 2 and gamma 2. Hemoglobin H is all the 4 are beta 4. And Bart's hemoglobin, all the 4s are gamma chains. And hemoglobin S or sickle cell hemoglobin, the alpha 2 and beta 2 at the 6th position, glutamic acid is replaced by the valine. And in hemoglobin C, the at position number 6 of the beta chain, the glutamic acid is replaced by the lysine. So remember the difference between the sickle cell and HB, hemoglobin S and hemoglobin C. And in the sickle form, there is valine in place of glutamic acid, and in hemoglobin C there is lysine for the in place of glutamic acid. Now the alpha thalassemias, they result from gene deletions. Remember, I have used the word gene deletions. One deletion, patient is a silent carrier, no clinical significance. And two deletions, the disease is remembered as alpha thalassemia trait, and the patient usually have mild hypochromic microcytic anemias. And they, when there are three deletions, it is known as hemoglobin H. It present in a variable severity manner, but less severe than the beta thalassemia major. Then when there are all the four deletions of the alpha thalassemia, we call it as Bart's hemoglobin. So remember, when there are all the four alpha thalassemia alpha chains absent, we call it as Bart's hemoglobin, and the disease is known as hydrops fetalis. It is a serious fetal condition in which there is abnormal accumulation of fluid in the compartments, including the patient may have ascites, pleural effusion, pericardial effusion, skin edema, and in some patient it also may be associated with polyhydramnios and placental edema. Now alpha thalassemia, usually no treatment indicated. When there is four deletion, it is deletion disorder, the patient dies in utero because it is incompatible with life. Three or fewer deletions have only mild anemia. Now beta thalassemias, they result from point mutations. Now recall, the alpha thalassemias, I use the word deletions. And now beta thalassemias, there are mutations on the genes. So remember, there is clear cut difference between the deletion and mutation. In beta thalassemia, there are mutations. So severity depends upon where there is mutation. No beta globin synthesis. Beta plus, reduced synthesis. So disease result in an overproduction of alpha globin chains. When there are no beta globin chains, naturally there is overproduction of alpha globin chain, which precipitate in the cells, and they cause this, and there is splenic sequestration of the RBCs leading to the hemolysis, and erythropoiesis increases. Sometimes it becomes extramedullary. Beta thalassemia clinical. Beta thalassemia minor. It is a minor point mutation. There is minimal anemia, and usually no treatment is required. In the beta thalassemia intermedia, it is an homozygous minor point mutation, but it may become severe, and then it is heterozygote. Most often do not require chronic transfusions. Beta thalassemia major is a serious disorder. It is also known as Cooley's anemia. There are severe gene mutations. They need careful observation, and sometimes mostly they require intensive treatment. Beta thalassemia major, इन बीटा थैलेसीमिया में जे देर इज रिड्यूस्ड और नॉन एग्जिस्टेंट प्रोडक्शन ऑफ बीटा ग्लोबुलिंस, देर इज एज ए रिजल्ट देर इज पुअर ऑक्सीजन कैरिंग कैपेसिटी ऑफ द आरबीसीज एंड दैट इज वाई द चिल्ड्रन दे फेल टू थ्राइव दे हैव दे प्रेजेंट विद पुअर ब्रेन डेवलपमेंट इन अदर वर्ड्स दे मे बी मेंटली रिटार्डेड एंड देर इज इंक्रीज अल्फा ग्लोबुलिन प्रोडक्शन एंड प्रेसिपिटेशन and the RBC precursors are destroyed within the marrow. Then increased splenic destruction of the defunct or dysfunctional RBCs occurs, leading to anemia, classical triad of anemia, jaundice and splenomegaly. So remember the classical triad of anemia, jaundice and splenomegaly. If you find these three features, the diagnosis you should clinch the easy diagnosis that the patient may be a candidate of a case of beta thalassemia major or Cooley's anemia. Then is the other features are of the Cooley's anemia or beta thalassemia major, there may be hyperplastic bone marrow and there is ineffective erythropoiesis, there are RBCs are precursors are destroyed, there is poor bone growth, there is frontal bossing and the patient may present to you with the bony pain and there is increase in the extramedullary erythropoiesis. But since the severe hemolysis is going on, the patient must be having iron overload and there is increased absorption and transfusion and as a result of increased absorption and multiple transfusion iatrogenically, the patients can develop endocrine disorders like Bronze diabetes because of the involvement of the iron deposition in the pancreas and the patient may get cardiomyopathy because of the iron deposits in the myocardium and the patient can have hemochromatosis or liver disease and ultimately patient can go into the liver failure if the disease is advanced one. The patient will be having hypochromic microcytic anemia and on peripheral film you will be finding target cells, nucleated RBCs and isocytosis, reticulocytosis may be graded up to say 6 to 10, 12% or more depending upon the severity of the reticulocytosis, hemolysis. And the classical test for the diagnosis of the thalassemia major is Hb electrophoresis or hemoglobin electrophoresis. It shows increased hemoglobin HbA2. The delta globin production is more. And there is increased hemoglobin, fetal hemoglobin, which means that there is gamma globin production. The patient may have hyperbilirubinemia and the LFTs are abnormal and it sometimes immediately the patient can have abnormal or deranged LFT, but sometimes there may be a delayed finding. Then the patient can have thyroid disorders or thyroid functional disorders, which means that the patient's T3, T4 and TSH may be abnormal. The patient will be having hyperglycemia, already mentioned, because of the Bronze diabetes. These are the two common endocrine disorders, I mean the two organs are thyroid and pancreas, which are involved with the beta thalassemia because of the hemolysis, more iron production, deposition of the iron in the thyroid as well in the pancreas. So these are the lab findings of the beta thalassemia major. Now you see there are target cell and there are teardrop cells shown in this slide. And the treatment options are chronic transfusion therapy 2 to 4 weekly. And you should wait when you find that there is hemoglobin low. The purpose is to offer the transfusion as less as possible because it maximizes the growth and development of the patient, it suppresses the patient's own ineffective erythropoiesis and excessive dietary iron absorption. The benefit of transfusion is that it maximizes the growth and development. It suppresses the patient's own ineffective thrombosis, and it inhibits the iron absorption. Then the patch cell transfusions, also known as red cell concentrates, and patch cells are red blood cells that have been separated from the whole blood. They are typically used in anemia, that is either resulting in symptoms or when the hemoglobin is less than 7 to 8 gram per deciliter. So remember from now onward that if you have diagnosed the patient as a case of major thalassemia, and usually the victims are children, therefore try to maintain his hemoglobin greater than 10. If you find the hemoglobin around 7 to 8, then you have to offer the transfusion, often monthly, to maintain the hemoglobin above 10 to 12 or in the range of 10 to 12. That is the optimal range. The two benefits: less transfusion are required. The second benefit is that the patient's growth continues. The patient does not suffer from other disorders because of the anemia. Then the chelation therapy is the second treatment modality. It binds the free iron and reduces the hemosiderin deposition. Then the iron chelation is done with the desferrioxamine. It is offered in the 8 to 12 hours infusion form and 5 times a week. There is a risk of Yersinia infections with the desferrioxamine transfusion therapy. You start after 1 year of chronic transfusions or when the ferritin is greater than 100,000 nanogram per deciliter, or oral desferrioxamine can also be given in the form of 20 milli at the rate of in the dose of 20 milligram per kg of the body weight daily. You also add ascorbic acid because it increases excretion of iron in the urine, and you also offer folate supplement because the development of the RBCs is required. So simultaneously, when you are offering the ascorbic acid and you are offering the chelation therapies, do add ascorbic acid. The benefits have been described. Then ultimately, when all options have failed, you have to opt for the splenectomy. The indications are when the transfusion requirements increase 50% in 6 months, and when the red cells requirement per year is greater than 250 cc per kg of the body weight. So remember, 250 cc per kg of the body weight per year, when this much high requirement is there, you have no option but splenectomy. And there is also severe leukopenia or thrombocytopenia accompanying the anemia, then you should go for the splenectomy. The complications and emergencies: the sepsis, usually caused by the encapsulated organisms, Streptococcus pneumoniae is an example. The patient, other complications may be cardiomyopathy presenting with the CHF, and you have to use the diuretic digoxin and desferrioxamine. And similarly, when you are having endocrinopathies in the patient and the patient present with the DKA, take care during hydration so as not to precipitate CHF from fluid overload, because the patient is also having cardiomyopathy. I mean the DKA along with cardiomyopathy, so you have to be watchful, keeping in view both of the conditions simultaneously while treating the patient. Anticipatory guidance and follow-up: immunizations are usually required when you do the splenectomy. Meningococcal vaccine, pneumovax vaccine, HIP vaccine, and annual influenza vaccine is mandatory. Follow-up for signs of the diabetes, hypothyroidism, and gonadotropin deficiency because of the endocrinopathy caused by the iron overload. The follow-up for signs of the cardiomyopathy or chronic heart failure, follow for signs of the hepatic dysfunction, and then osteoporosis prevention is done with the help of the diet, exercise, hormonal supplementation, and the usual drug used is bisphosphonate. It is an osteoclast inhibiting drug, and follow the ferritin levels finally. The coming things on the horizon are oral chelation agents, ethylene diamine. Pharmacologically, it upregulates the gamma globin synthesis and increases the fetal hemoglobin. The patient the carrier oxygen better than hemoglobin 2. Okay, when you offer ethylene diamine, the oxygen carrying capacity is better. It will help in binding alpha globin and decreases their precipitation. So it prohibits the alpha globin indirectly, avoiding or averting the hemolysis, because the precipitation of the alpha globin results in hemolysis of the RBCs. So ethylene diamine, the novel agent, it is an antagonistic to the alpha globin precipitation. Then last resort, when all the things have been modalities of the treatment have been exhausted, you can consider the allogeneic stem cell transplantation. Gene therapy also is the last thought modality of treatment. You insert healthy beta gene into the stem cells and then transplant into the patient. The differential diagnosis is iron deficiency anemia, in which there is low MCP, low iron ferritin, low iron and low ferritin. And in thalassemia, iron is high, ferritin is high. In hemoglobinopathies, on electrophoresis, HbA2 and HbF are elevated, iron is replete. Then iron deficiency anemia with polycythemia vera. Remember the differential diagnosis of the, this is a unique differential diagnosis of the thalassemia, I mean the iron deficiency with the polycythemia vera, in which there will be microcytic anemia with normal or elevated red cell count. Remember this specific or unique combination. Then anemia of chronic disease and macrocytic anemia also should be given a consideration in the differential diagnosis of the thalassemia, but down the order. The signs, you see the pillar, then you see the frontal bossing on X-ray of the skull and cranial bone thickening. There is overgrowth of the zygomatic bone. The patient can have jaundice, and on X-ray demonstrate expansion of the diplo hair on end appearance. This is the hair on end appearance in the thalassemia. Now you see in the extramedullary hemoptysis going on in the ribs. Now these are the ribs you see, and the ribs are expanded and they look like as cannonball. Actually these are the expanded, grown out lower ends of the anterior ends of the ribs, and this is an extramedullary hemoptysis, hematopoiesis going on in the anterior ends of the ribs. On X-ray chest you can be misguided, but remember this X-ray so that you don't forget the beta thalassemia major leading on to the extramedullary hematopoiesis in the ribs. Hemoglobinopathies, then hemoglobin S, this is the predominant hemoglobin in people with sickle cell disease, which we'll be teaching later. Hemoglobin C, alpha 2, beta C, this results from a mutation in the beta globin gene and is the predominant hemoglobin found in people with hemoglobin C disease. Then the hemoglobin E, there is alpha 2, beta E, and this variant results from a mutation in the hemoglobin beta chain. People with hemoglobin E disease have a mild hemolytic anemia and mild splenomegaly. Hemoglobin E is common in Southeast Asia. Then hemoglobin constant spring, named after isolation in a Chinese family in the Jamaica. In this variant, a mutation in the alpha chain, alpha globin gene, produces an alpha globin chain that is abnormally long. Both the messenger RNA and the alpha chain protein are unstable. Hemoglobin H, it is B4, This is a tetramer composed of four beta globin chain. It occurs in only with extreme limitation of alpha chain availability. Hemoglobin H forms in people with the 3 gene alpha thalassemia, as well as in people with the combination of the 2 gene deletion alpha thalassemia and hemoglobin constant spring. BARDS I have already described to you. It is actually Hydrops fetalis, and the fetus usually dies in the utero. Then is the sickle cell anemia. It is an autosomal recessive disorder most commonly found in Africa. The abnormal hemoglobin, the cells are, which leads into the deformity of the cell, which assume the sickle shapes, and they produce the vaso-occlusive crisis because their shape is so that they are trapped in the vessels. The amino acid change in beta chain, and at position number 6, there is valine in place of glutamic acid. There is production of HBS instead of HBA. They are homozygous. They are also heterozygous variety, sickle cell trait. But the one benefit of sickle cell anemia is they have protection against the falciparum malaria. They may have sickling experience or hypoxia. Then the pathogenesis. Hemoglobin sickle cell polymerizes when deoxygenated. RBCs, they deform, they assume the sickle shape, and they are fragile. There is hemolysis, and they block the small vessels. The laboratory findings are the hemoglobin will be around 6 to 9 gram per deciliter, and the reticulocyte count may be 10 to 20%, as I mentioned earlier in the thalassemia, that the hemolysis, in the hemolysis sometimes the reticulocytosis may be very high, as high as 20%. So this is the classical example is sickle cell anemia. Then there will be high unconjugated bilirubin. CBC film peripheral picture will be showing classical sickle cell in the, and the target cell also. The other test for the sickle cell anemia is sickle solubility test positive. Then on HB erythropoiesis, you can have the confirmation of the different variants. You can find the SS, AS or HB variant of the sickle hemoglobin. The cord blood diagnosis for pneumococcal variation can also be found. Then sign and symptoms of the sickle cell anemia. The patient have chronic hemolysis tolerated to some extent, but in a crisis form there is no toleration. The patient can present to you with the vaso-occlusive painful crisis. There are microvascular occlusion. It affects the marrow as well. There is severe bony pain. It is triggered by the cold and triggered by the dehydration. It is triggered by the infection and it is triggered by the hypoxia as well. The patient can have hand and foot syndrome, and it is less than 3 years old. Usually the patient can have dactylitis. Then the patient can present with other acute conditions like acute abdomen, which is because of the occlusion of the mesenteric vessels. So whenever the patient, especially the younger patient, they present with the acute abdominal pain, you should also keep in mind that the occlusion of the mesenteric vessel may be because of the sickle cell anemia. And other findings, of course, may be anemia with jaundice. The CNS infarction can occur in 10% of the children, and they can also suffer from the stroke, seizures or cognitive defects. Then the transcranial Doppler ultrasonography indicates risk of stroke. Transfusion of blood reduces hemoglobin, sickle cell hemoglobin, and it avoids the risk. So other features may be avascular necrosis of the femoral head. The patient can present to you with the chronic leg ulcer, and low flow priapism may be found. Male patient can present to you with the, even the children can present to you with the priapism, and it is because of the hydration, alpha agonist phenylephrine. The aplastic crisis इस यूजली कॉज बाय दी पार्वो वायरस B19 इन्फेक्शन देर इज सडन रिडक्शन इन दी RBC प्रोडक्शन. देन दी सीक्वेस्ट्रेशन क्राइसिस ऑल्सो ए हॉलमार्क फीचर ऑफ द सिकल सेल एनीमिया इन विच देर इज बिकॉज ऑफ द सीक्वेस्ट्रेशन देर विल बी स्प्लेनिक एट्रोफी देर इज पूलिंग ऑफ ब्लड इन द स्प्लीन एंड लिवर देर मे बी ऑर्गेनोमेगाली एंड सीवियर एनीमिया. The patient can present to you with the shock requiring urgent transfusion and there is trigger of the vaso-occlusive crisis because of the hypoxemia. The patient can have chest syndrome, acute chest syndrome, acute life mimicking acute coronary syndrome. And because of the dehydration, the patient can have acidosis which result in a shift of the oxygen dissociation curve and there may be changes in the body temperature. On the diagnosis done by the hemoglobin electrophoresis, you can have hemoglobin S, hemoglobin SC, and you can have the hemoglobin S plus beta thalassemia, a combination of the beta thalassemia and sickle cell anemia. The complication of the sickle cell anemia or splenic infarction usually occurs in the children, and there it is because of the microvascular occlusion or infection. There will be poor growth, there may be the patient have chronic renal failure, there may be found gallstone, and patient can also have retinal disease, and patient can have the effects of the iron overload. The patient can have lung damage because of the hypoxia leading on to the because of the chronic hypoxia fibrosis and pulmonary hypertension, a rare cause of the pulmonary hypertension. Prevention is genetic counseling, prenatal test, parental education and prevents 90% of the deaths. So remember, prevention is more helpful, which means genetic counseling, prenatal test, parental education is the hallmark points, salient points of the prevention of the sickle cell anemia. Now on the left side is normal RBC shape and on the right side is sickle cell RBC shape, which is a lethal disease. All the lethal features have been described to you. Management of sickle cell disease: hydroxycarbamide if frequent crisis and high if there is high production of the hemoglobin F. Then the splenic infarction, hyposplenism can happen, and give antibiotics and immunization. There is risk of septicemia. Admit the patient, give antibiotics. Criteria: if hemoglobin is less than 5 gram per deciliter, WBC less than 5000, and the patient is having temperature 40 degree centigrade, and the patient is having severe pain along with hydration, dehydration, and there are lung infiltrates, then the treatment option is emergent treatment option is bone marrow transplantation. Any question, if you want, you can ask on the YouTube or Facebook. Thank you very much for joining me. I will be waiting for your feedback of the lecture, and the attendance time is between 11:30 to 12:15. Those who will be marking late, they will be marked absent. Okay, goodbye from Akhtar Said Trust Hospital.